I am here to talk about my review of Star Wars The Last Jedi. Now, this is probably the most hype I've ever had for a movie, or a Star Wars movie in general as well. There was so much hype. You're thinking, you got the light, you got the dark, and it's very just... I've been hyped for this for 8 months, and I went to see it, and it just was not, it just was not what I was expecting. It was, now, some of the things that I had a problem with weren't just the blatant things, but also the things that weren't as blatant, like the timeline of this. If you go back to the original trilogy, episodes 4, 5, and 6 of the Star Wars trilogy, that was over a 4-year time span. Go to episodes 1, 2, 3, and the prequel trilogy, that was over a span of 20 to 30 years. Now you go to The Last Jedi, and this new trilogy, over The Force Awakens and Last Jedi, it is over a 3.5-day period. So you're trying to tell me that Rey here learns the Force in 3.5 days, and she becomes this master. Okay, and before we get any more further in this, I'm going to say that there's spoilers. It's a spoiler review. So, if you've not seen the movie, I'm gonna ask you to leave right now, or you can check out my non-spoiler review. Now, give you a couple seconds. Alright, so, when we first start off, We see Poe Dameron come up to this giant dreadnought, and he's playing with Hux, and so I'm thinking, wow, this is going to be a good film. So he disobeys what Leia tells him to do, and he goes, blows up the dreadnought. Lots of people lost their lives, the entire fleet was destroyed, but, you know, he brought down a dreadnought. You know, Leia brings him down to Commander, which I have no problem with, but then we get to this big space battle, okay, and we see Kylo Ren coming in with his fellow TIE fighters. He's in his TIE silencer, and he has his chance to blow up the main bay where all the leaders of the resistance are. And when, right before he does this, he's deciding his mom's there. He ends up not killing her, but his TIE fighters come in and they just blow it up. Apparently, Admiral Ackbar, he died in that, but apparently what happened was he screamed out, it's a trap. I didn't hear it, but it was apparently in there. But problem here, Leia blows up. She's in space. We all think she's dead. But then she comes back, and she opens her eyes, starts moving her hands, and she uses the Force to bring herself back to the... Now, this movie messes with a lot of things, a lot of things with the Force, and it's not a problem when it's a couple things, but this was a lot of things. That don't. Leia has been in space, and she would already be dead, but somehow she uses the Force to bring herself back to the ship. I find that insane. There's no way that she did that. No way. And it just makes no sense. I thought that would be a good way for her to go out. Not the best, but it was a good way. But, and then she's alive at the end of the film. It makes... And now... And so, then we cut to Leia... Or, we cut to Rey and Luke. And so... Rey gives Luke the lightsaber. And Luke just throws it off. And I thought that was just a funny joke. But then we find out he really means it. It's like, what? I mean, they completely disrespect Luke as a legend in Star Wars, and so it is, they completely disrespect. And then he goes and he gets milk from this creature. I didn't want to see him get green milk out of this creature. I didn't want to see that. It's nothing. You could have left that out, okay? And I did not like the way they took Luke in this. They completely disrespect his character in this film. And then apparently, now you can connect with each other. You can have talks with each other, which that's completely understandable how you can have talks in the Force. But then you can Kylo Rey gets water on her hand, and then Kylo has water coming out of his. He has water coming out of his hand, so that was very insane. And then we see, this is after Rey comes off now. She leaves to go find Kylo Ren. You're left with Luke here, going to the tree. He's about to burn it. And then you see Yoda come around as a ghost, and he completely blows up the entire tree with lightning, and he's a Force ghost. How does he have anything? How does he have enough power? He's a ghost. He shouldn't have power to do things in the real world. And that made no sense. And then he keeps Luke out of the tree. And I mean, I love to see Yoda back, but it's like the way they use the Force in this makes no sense. So then she goes to Snoke, and, you know, she goes up to Snoke, and you figure out that Snoke was actually linking them, and then Kylo here, Snoke says he feels what Kylo is doing, but Kylo tricks him, and he kills him, so, why even have the hype for this character? We were all waiting to see his background. We all wanted to see more of this character. He's apparently this all-natural and powerful being. The most powerful Force users in the galaxy. And you kill him off? Really? The direction in this movie made no sense. And then, while all this is going on, you have this chase scene. I wouldn't even call it a chase scene. You have Snoke's ship chasing after the entire resistance was on this one ship. They're down to 400,000 people around there. And so, somehow, the First Order doesn't have enough ships in the fleet to maybe call two and blow up the resistance fighter. I mean, I get they have a force field, but you can call in some ships for backup. I mean, this is slow. This makes no sense why they couldn't call in backup. And why they just... And it just made no sense. And then you have this new character come in for Leia. I'm just going to call her Purple Hair. Okay, so Purple Hair here won't tell Poe what's going on. Because Poe wants to know what the plan is. Because, no, he was the captain, but then was brought down to commander by General Leia. But he wants to know what's going on because he wants to make sure the resistance can win. And she tells him no, because she doesn't like him, and she calls him a flyboy. That is it. He has a right to know. The entire fleet has a right to know. Because you can't get anything done if you didn't tell the fleet that you were gonna ram the ship. You should have said something. I mean, you don't tell the fleet, you don't tell the captain of the X-Wing fleet, you won't tell him what's going on because you don't like him. Oh yeah, and then I forgot the most pointless thing in this entire movie is it's Finn and this new character, Rose Tico. Rose is apparently this maintenance worker, and her sister died on the bombing. She was the last bomber left, and she blew up the dreadnought, but so that was sad and all, but this character, good actor, terrible character. And so, basically, Finn and Rose come up with this mission where they're going to, where basically, Finn, Rose, and Poe all team together, and they call Maz, and she finds them this code breaker that's gonna get them onto Snoke's ship, and it's going to stop that. It's because they have this new system where they can, track them in hyperspace. So they're gonna get this codebreaker. They're gonna get on the ship, and they're gonna get into this thing so that they can stop this hyperspace thing for enough time for them to get away. And so they find this plan, and they go to this planet, and so basically they go to this city on this planet called Canto Bight, and it's full of the richest people in the galaxy, and Rose refers to them as the most evil people in the galaxy, and I'm thinking these people sell weapons, machinery, metal, and ships to the Rebellion and to the First Order. She refers to them as evil people. I mean, they were just doing what they needed to do to become rich. I mean, I get where she's coming from, but I mean, seriously, there's no point. And so then they get here, and they're looking for this guy with this red flower thing, I think it was, on his shirt. He's the codebreaker, and so they get inside of this casino, and they finally find the guy. Oh yeah, BB-8's along too. Totally forgot. But they find the guy, and then they're arrested for parking violations. Out of everything, they're arrested for parking violations. So they're put in jail, and then they find, and you know, you think there's no way out, but then they find this codebreaker. It's not the codebreaker they were looking for, but they find this codebreaker, and this is Benicio del Toro's character, and so DJ, and so DJ is basically all, he says he's a codebreaker too, and so he's gonna get him on the ship, and then he opens his cell door. Like, he could have escaped this entire time. And I'm here thinking, why the heck didn't you do this sooner? Were you just waiting for them to show up? And so then, Finn and Rose escape. They look, and they see there are these animals that are being tortured, and animal cruelty and stuff. And so then they get on these animals, and they find this kid. And apparently, they show him this ring, show him that they're with the Resistance, he's all good. So, they escape with these animals, they're running amok through the city, they destroy the city, destroy all the rich people's stuff, and they escape in the field. Benicio del Toro's character, along with BB-8, picks them up on the ship. DJ and BB-8 pick them up on the ship. And so, Finn says, it was nice to make them pay. He said this toward the rich people, that this is the best thing that happened, for them to rummage through the city with these animals. Now, I'm here thinking, you do know that the poor people on this planet are going to be the ones responsible for picking up the mess that you just made. So, then they get on the ship, and Benicio del Toro figures out who's running this, and that there is no good or evil with these rich people. They just want money, because they were dealing with the Resistance and the First Order. So, anyway. Then Luke here, Ray tries to get Luke to train her. He doesn't. Again, tries. She doesn't. He doesn't. Again, he doesn't. And then out of nowhere, he's just like, alright, fine. I'll train you three reasons why I want to jet it in. So, he trains her the three reasons, and Ray has this vision where there's this black pit on the island. Similar to the cave, I think it was like the Cave of Death or something, that Yoda showed Luke. So she goes into this pit, and this whole scene was bizarre. So she falls in this pit of water, and it says, she asks this mirror, magic mirror, it's like we're in Sleeping Beauty. She has this mirror, show me my parents, and basically does a, her, like, it's like you're copy and pasting her, and whenever she would snap, all of them would snap, and it was the most pointless scene. It did nothing. And then she comes out, she talks to Kylo again, and Kylo says that Luke came in with his lightsaber, was about, looked like he was about to murder him. So Kylo, the only thing that Kylo could do, pulled his lightsaber, and he brought down his cave on his master Luke, and then he burned the temple and left with a couple of Jedi. So he said Luke brought anger. Before, Luke told him, both sides of the stories are true, but Luke had told him that he felt great anger and hate in Kylo. So the only thing that he could do was trying to save everybody. Then he got in there and he hesitated. And he thought, this isn't the right thing to do. This was after he pulled his lightsaber and Kylo looked up and he thought that, oh no, I'm about to get killed. And that is what brought him to the darks. Not fully, but he was already possessed by Snoke, is what Luke said. So I get both sides. But then Rey pulls out a stick and she starts fighting Luke because she doesn't like what he did to Kylo. And Luke also pulls out a stick, not a lightsaber, but a stick, and Rey has her pull, and they start fighting, and Rey brings Luke down somehow. She pulls out a lightsaber, and I'm like, she like Mary Sue or something, because she's basically all heavenly god here, okay? She runs off, and she goes to Kylo. This is where Snoke was killed. I am getting a little off, so this is where after, this is before Yoda comes. And when Yoda comes, he's like, it's time to let go. Rey has all the knowledge she needs. She doesn't need the books in the ancient temple. This is after he burns it with his frickin' lightning bolt from the sky, which I don't frickin' understand. But, and he's like I said, she doesn't need the books. She already knows everything and some crap. Like, why is some almighty god now? Because apparently she already knows everything. She doesn't need the book. She doesn't need a train. I'm like, what? Why? I don't think she knows everything. And so it's just, it doesn't make any sense. How he can bring electricity down. I mean, she's not a god. She doesn't know everything. She's actually pretty freaking terrible. She goes right at Snoke and doesn't do anything. So basically, after Kylo kills Snoke, him and Rey team up, and they fight the Praetorian Guards in one of the best lightsaber scenes. That was a pretty darn amazing scene. It was pretty good. And so, after they get through these Praetorian Guards, they both, Kylo asks Rey to join, and she's like, no way, no. And so, they both fight the lightsabers. Lightsaber split or something. Pretty sure. I don't know. But then, this is when they're evacuating the Resistance ship after all this storm. The Resistance ship is being evacuated. So basically, Laura Dern's character, Purple Hair, she stays on the ship, and she uses all the juice they have left with light speed, and she cuts Snoke's ship in half, and she dies. Good way for her to go off. Hated her character. So then all the Resistance are being blown up and stuff, and while all this is going on, Captain Phasma, while all this is going on, we have Benicio Del Toro's character. They're on the ship. This is before it blows up. They have his character with Rey. Or no, they have his character with Finn and Rose. They're about to get to this thing. And you figure out, oh no. Big surprise, he betrays them. So, now if Captain Phasma kicks them, they're about to be executed. She says, on my command. And then the ship gets blown up. And then everything's on fire. Captain Phasma's on one side of the room with a bunch of lined up stormtroopers, now Rose and Finn are on the other side. They get into this big fight. All in all, Phasma thinks Finn is dead. Finn comes back and knocks Phasma, and then she dies. So, 3 minutes of time. Terrible character. No point. Why would you even bring her in? And then, now we go to Crait, where the rest of the Resistance has gone to this base where this was an old Rebel base from the original Galactic Civil War. And basically what happens is They get into this big fight. And somehow they have these big, basically amped up AT-ATs that are brought down with stormtroopers and Kylo Ren's ship and all the resistance in here. And then they have these little speeder things that go across the dirt. And then Finn's left. All of them are knocked out. Poe and the rest of them retreat back. And Finn's, they have this big weapon the First Order does, and they're about to knock this huge door down with it. And it's so powerful. Finn says he has to do this, and he's going to, just he's like, so he's about to go into it and save the resistance, and then Rose comes out of nowhere and knocks him out of the way. And I thought this is going to be a perfect moment for Finn, because all of Force Awakens and Last Jedi, he's wanted to run away. Now he finally faces his fear. Rose knocks him out of the way, and she's like, you have to save what you love. And I'm like, I don't think he ever liked you. You liked him as a character. You liked him, but he does not like you. That entire part made no sense. And then Finn somehow carries her all the way back to the base without anyone noticing. And then all hope seems lost, and then Luke comes out. Almighty Luke, and he comes out, I'm like, gosh, this could save the movie. And he comes out, and he's standing there, and then Kylo says, fire, and they keep firing. It's like a minute scene, he's very angry, and he keeps firing, and he says, keep firing. And there's this big pit. And then we see Luke just come out, and he brushes it off. Now that was a cool scene. We're all like, wow, it's Luke Skywalker. And then he comes out, and Kylo comes out, and Luke's dodging all of his lightsaber. When he comes out with the lightsaber, Luke just bends down. Really cool scene. I'm like, wow, I'm about to see Luke just get into this massive fight. This could save the movie. And then Kylo goes, he cuts right through him, and he's a freaking hologram. How he did that, I don't know. Force made no sense in this movie. But after this, we see Luke says, see you around, kid. Referring back to Han Solo's line. And Kylo's really upset. And then we see Luke on his island. And looks like he's about to have a heart attack. And he stops. He disappears on crate. You see him on the island. And then he just disappears. I don't know if he had a heart attack or what. We're all like, oh my god, he's alive. He's going to be in the next movie. And then we're just like, he goes into the Force because apparently it wasn't too much power. It looked like he had a heart attack. Dead of the twin sons, which is pretty cool. Referring back to the old movie, he died looking at a twin sunset. And then they all escape. They find a way out by following these crystal foxes, is what I'm gonna call them. But then, oh no, there's a bunch of rocks and they can't get out of the way. Apparently Rey flies by and she sees all these crystal foxes come out, and she sees the rocks and she uses the Force and something to lift them up, and all the resistance escapes and can now somehow fit on the Millennium Falcon. If they can all fit on the Millennium Falcon, then there's a problem. It's not a resistance anymore. It's a group of people that just want to stop the First Order. And it's like probably 30 people left with the resistance now. If they can fit on the Millennium Falcon, there's a problem. It's a big problem. And another problem, when she's flying over looking for them, there's these canyons, and you're flying over canyons, and then she stops, and I'm like, well, where's the field that they just had the big battle in? And if she just flew over all those canyons, how far did they all walk? It didn't seem like very far. And so, and then C-3PO, before they get through this, they're like, oh, we need to find an exit, and then C-3PO says, the odds to find an exit in here are 15,242 to 1, I think it was. That was pretty funny. Pretty sure I remembered the number right. But, yes, basically at the end, they're on the Resistance, and they're all on the Millennium Falcon. That's the rest of the Resistance. Fly away, that's the end of the movie. And so... Well, no, that's not the end of the movie. Then there's a scene they go back to Canto Bight, which everybody can believe probably about a useless scene. But we see the kid, the small kid with the broom that was in with the, all those creatures. And he sweeps and brooms and cares for the creatures. He's a slave on the planet. This is the kid that Rose showed that they're on the Resistance. And so we see the kid, he moves over, and he uses the Force for the broom as he's looking up at stars, looking back on A New Hope when Luke was looking at the stars looking for a new beginning. And so there's definitely other Force users, so we know that Luke isn't the last Jedi, but Rey's not really a Jedi. No, Kylo's not a Jedi. This kid's probably not going to be a Jedi, because there's nobody to really train him. You have books, but it's not like the original thing where you have Master and a Padawan. So they're not going to be Jedi, but they are going to be some, in a way, some kind of Jedi. But we saw Porgs, we saw Crystal Foxes, we saw these other creatures on Canto Bight. And we saw BB-8, BB-9E, some other weird creatures, and other Star Wars stuff, but it, overall, it's not a good film. It didn't, there were a couple cameos and stuff, but it wasn't, it just, it completely disrespected Luke's character as the legend of Luke Skywalker. It took everything the wrong direction. Apparently the entire Resistance was down to 1,400 people. Then it's not even a Resistance. Now it's not even a Resistance. And it overall, now Ryan Johnson has left a mess for J.J. Abrams to pick up, which I'm hoping he can pick up in the final movie. But this has been my spoiler review of Star Wars The Last Jedi. Now I have a ranking that we're going to start with. We have Go See It, and then at the end we have Don't Bother. In the middle we have It Depends. And so on this list I'm going to say It Depends. I'm going to put it right in the middle. Now basically what It Depends means depends what kind of person you are. If you are like the general audience going to see this film, I think you're going to thoroughly enjoy it. But if you are a true Star Wars fan going to see this film, you're not going to enjoy it. It is disrespectful to many characters. Best character in the movie, I would say, is Poe Dameron. But it... because I love his action, trying to take charge. But, yeah, I'm going to put it at It Depends. General audience, go see it. You're going to love it. If you're a fan, you're going to hate it. It's my point of view from in my book, it is the worst Star Wars movie, or second worst Star Wars movie, only ahead of Attack of the Clones. This has been my spoiler review of Star Wars The Last Jedi. Hope you enjoyed, and I'll see you in the next one.